Father in heaven, we're thankful today for your many blessings. Thank you for your grace and thank you for your mercies. Thank you for your love, your faithfulness toward us. And today, dear God, we choose to be faithful to you. Today, we choose to be footstool Christians in these closing hours of Earth's history. Thank you for the promise of the Father. Revive us, reform us, we pray, in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. All right, friends, welcome one, welcome all to this midday power surge, your spiritual oasis on this pilgrim journey toward heaven. All right, friends, welcome. All right, friends, I see you. David, Carla, Renee, Eric, Calbert, Patricia. We had such a challenging morning, but praise God, we are here. All right, friends, I want to begin by saying this for this midday power surge. This is Tuesday, February 4th, 2020. Please do not renege on your New Year's resolutions that you made to God several weeks ago when this new calendar year began. My friends, you have to stay consecrated, committed, sanctified, dedicated to Jesus Christ. Death can come at any time. The close of probation can come at any time. The second coming of Christ can come at any time. And I want all of us to be saved. And to be saved then, we must be saved now. Amen, my friends. To be ready then, we must be ready now. How many of you believed that you will live to see 2020? Not me, friends. I did not believe we would live to see 2020, and we are here. So the great question is, why has Christ delayed? What is Christ waiting on? Who is Christ waiting on? And friends, the resounding, emphatic answer is this, that Christ is waiting on me. Christ is waiting on you. He is waiting for all of us to become, as I said before, footstool Christians in these last days. What does that mean? We are going to delve into it. And friends, may I add, he's not going to wait forever. And that's why I have been emphasizing for the past several days and weeks, we must be ready every single day to live or to die for Christ. Does that make sense? All right, friends, without further ado, let's go to Acts chapter 2. In Acts chapter 2, we find a principal theme that was proclaimed on the day of Pentecost to usher in the harvest of souls. And that principal theme must be proclaimed now, just before the second coming of Christ. The great harvest of Revelation chapter 14, verse 9 through verse 16. And that principal theme is in verse 34 and verse 35 of Acts chapter 2, that Christ is now sitting at the right hand of the Father until, adverb of time, until he makes his foes, his enemies, his footstool. That's Acts chapter 2, verse 34 and verse 35. Question, my friends, when, after which great event, did Jesus sit at the right hand of his Father until he would make his enemies his footstool? After which event, my friends, those of you in the forum, send in the answer. Is it not? It is. After his death, burial, resurrection, and ascension to heaven. Look with me at Hebrews. Hebrews chapter 10. I'm going to read this one. Hebrews chapter 10. Look with me at verse number 12 and 13. It says, but this man, Jesus, after he had offered one sacrifice for sins forever, sat down on the right hand of God, from henceforth expecting until his enemies, underscore enemies, his enemies be made his footstool. All right, friends. Now, what does it mean that Christ is sitting at the right hand of the Father. Answer, those of you in the forum, what does that mean? It means he is interceding for us in the heavenly sanctuary. The Bible tells us, look at this, my friends, in Romans chapter 8. Romans chapter 8, the Bible tells us in verse 34 of Romans, the 8th chapter. The Bible says this, who is he that condemneth? It is Christ that died, yea, rather, that is risen again, who is even at the right hand of God, who also maketh intercession for us. So he's sitting at the right hand of God, which means what? He's interceding. Who is that? Teaching the world in all nations, the word in all nations. He is petitioning his Father. Amen to that, my friends. That is what he's doing in the holy place. But where is Christ now? Since October 22nd, 1844, in the most holy place of the heavenly sanctuary. He's sitting there at the right hand of the Father until he makes his enemies, plural, his footstool. Question, is Christ going to intercede for us forever? What's your answer, my friends, in the forum? Save to Serve International. First-time viewers, put that comment in the comment section. Will he intercede forever? Oh, no. He's sitting now, but one day, the Bible says, he will stand up. What does it mean that Christ will stand up one day? It means his intercession will be over. Salvation will be over. The work of redemption will be over. Go with me. Luke chapter 13. The Bible tells us this in Luke chapter 13. And this is what Christ is waiting on, friends. Luke chapter 13. Mark these verses. Verse 25 through verse 30. I'm simply going to read verse 25. When once the master of the house is risen up. Don't forget that term, risen up, and hath shut the door. And you begin to stand without, you're on the outside now, and to knock at the door saying, Lord, Lord, open unto us. And he shall answer and say unto you, I know you not whence you are. And it goes on, your probation is closed. He is risen up. He's now what, friends? Standing up. Question, friends, at what great event will Christ stand up? Will Christ close human probation? What is that great event? Those of you in the forum, it is the mark of the beast crisis of Revelation chapter 14, verse 9, verse 10, Revelation 15. Okay, Alicia. Okay, Michelle, Samara, and Luke. Revelation 15, verse 1. The plagues come. Mark of the beast. Once everybody makes their decision, probation closes. May I give you a scripture? Go to Ezekiel. Ezekiel chapter 8. The Bible tells us in verse, mark these verses, verse 16 through verse 18. At the Sunday worship crisis throughout the land, probation begins to close. Ezekiel 8, 16 to 18. Ezekiel 9, verse 1 through verse 6. Verse number 3 says, and the glory of the God of Israel was gone up from the cherub whereupon he was to the threshold of the house. And the final sealing takes place. And then probation closes on those who don't have the mark of God for salvation. But those who have the mark of Satan, the mark of the beast for damnation. How close are we to the Son of the Law? So what is Christ waiting on? To stop interceding until we, until he makes his enemies his footstool. How close are we to the Son of the Law, my friends? Beloved, I'm going to share with you again. They are calling for And they're now saying a green Sabbath is an obligation to combat climate change. It is the cheapest method. Take a look. Here it is, my friends. February 4th, 2020. The tablet, top left of your screen. The Sabbath in an era of climate change. The multiplicitous nature of the crises demands multiple solutions, such as political, economic, technological, psychological, ethical, behavioral, and even what, friends? Spiritual. Then it says, watch carefully, we need the Sabbath day of rest to combat climate change. Last phrase, it will provide a platform for ongoing meditating on our environmental sins and their consequences one day out of seven to combat climate change. It goes on. This article says, choose a day, whether Saturday, Sunday, or Friday. Red words, I urge all those who belong to traditions or congregations that keep the Sabbath, whether on Friday, Saturday, or Sunday, to observe it. My friend, what happened in the 3rd, 4th, and 5th centuries? Sunday Sabbath and God's 7th-day Sabbath were brought on the same platform, all right, friends, in the world. Until what happened? After council, the Sunday Sabbath was elevated. And correspondingly, proportionately, God's 7th-day Sabbath was denigrated until God's Sabbath keepers were persecuted. How close are we? And that took place under the Black Horse. All right, friends. And then came the Pale Horse. That's Revelation 6. White, red, black, and pale. Where are we, my friends? It goes on. This article says the UN, the United Nations, came up with a non-denominational environmental Sabbath already in 1990. It is already on the books. Last sentence, you could read all of this. Last sentence, red words. They're calling for a weekly green Sabbath. Then they say it need have nothing to do with God. It's simply about the environment, but we know its trajectory. Based on prophecy, it will have a spiritual undertone. Here it is, my friends, a green Sabbath to save Babylon, to save the earth, a green image, bow down and worship, or else you will burn in that fiery furnace, seven times hot. Ah, my friends, look at this. That's the UN. Earth Sabbath. All right. Have you forgotten this article? The 10 green commandments of Laodicea? The Sabbath the Pope is pushing and other religions are pushing have a spiritual undertone. It's religious. They can't deceive us. All right, friends, come back. It says, watch carefully. This could prove, first sentence, to be the one of the cheapest environmental solutions at humanity's disposal. Don't forget that. It's the cheapest way. Just rest on the Sabbath. Then it says in blue words, if we really believe that radical change in our behavior is necessary for environmental reasons, I certainly do. Then, don't these reasons make Sabbath, along with other environmental solutions, an obligation? Sabbath is an obligation to combat climate change. We're here, my friends. This is nothing new. Here it is, greensabbath.org. A green Sabbath to combat climate change. And they're telling us, my friends, It is one of the cheapest way. It won't cost us, first sentence, $16.5 trillion. Just rest on the Sabbath. Green Sabbath, one day per week. All right, friends. And they said the UN Sabbath is annually, but now they're calling for a weekly one. Friends, we are here. Notice now what this says.
And that's the ground that we all stand on together.
That's beautiful. I just got to add, before, David, before you jump in with the question, I just got to, because you mentioned Ramadan and Lent, there's actually some research that's been done about the Sabbath observance in Israel. Energy consumption drops by like 40%. And, you know, it's one day out of the week, but it is. If you think about living in a particular way, and if we could build these as habits, and in Yom Kippur, it drops to some, you know, phenomenally low level of energy consumption. But these are possible, and our religious traditions give us windows into behaving that way.
Mm. That's clear, right, friends?
Excellent
it's
connection.
Nothing new. Notice here, friends, we know what the Pope is calling for. Breaking news, my friends. I'm digging into my archives. Look what I unearthed. Look at this. January 24th, 2020, headline, Pennsylvania Blue Laws. It's illegal to play ball on Sundays in most towns. How that once cost a 23-year-old man his life. This is how the article began. As a young man ran down the alley, a policeman in pursuit with his revolver drawn, his gun drawn, a woman ran alongside. For God's sake, don't shoot, she pleaded. The officer shot the man. Patrick Patsy Joyce wasn't just a victim of police brutality. Oh no, he was a victim of Pennsylvania's blue laws. The 23-year-old was being chased by police in Philadelphia that day in May 1921 over a dispute about a baseball being tossed around on the Sabbath. Blue laws were enacted nationwide to preserve the Lord's Day for prayer and rest. Pennsylvania had plenty of them, one of which made it a crime to play baseball or football on Sundays. 99 years later, that's technically still the case. Did you hear that, my friends? Did you read that? In much of the state of Pennsylvania, including Allentown. The same spirit is here of Revelation 13, verse 15 through verse 17. We have read, we have heard of people being thrown in chain gangs who disregarded Sunday blue laws, imprisoned, jailed for disregarding Sunday blue laws, but this is now people were shot. Look at this same article. It said, Roland Parks, a teenager, was shot in the stomach, we are friends, in Virginia. Why? For loafing on store porches on Sunday while church services are being held. The constable who shot him was applauded, commended, lauded by the mayor. And this was said, now they will know that what we mean to enforce the law. Now they will know that we mean to enforce the law. The same spirit is here. Back to my point. What are your thoughts, my friends, in the forum? It's coming. That same spirit of the dragon. Revelation 13, 15 through verse 17. But what is Christ waiting on? To close his work of intercession. Not so much the Sunday law. Not the Pope. Not a green Sabbath. What does the Bible say? Christ is waiting on to close his work of intercession. He will sit at the right hand of the Father until he makes his enemies his footstool. What does that mean? Write this down. Who are Christ's two enemies? Does anyone know in the forum? Who are Christ's two enemies? The Bible tells us Christ's two primary enemies. Number one, Satan. Put it down. Number two, death. Go to Luke chapter 10. Luke chapter 10. The Bible tells us in Luke chapter 10, my friends, verse 18, verse 19, Christ says, I give you power to tread upon serpents, scorpions, and over all the power of the enemy. Go to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. The Bible tells us in 1 Corinthians 15, verse 25, verse 26, that death is the enemy of mankind. So Christ is sitting there interceding until he makes his enemies his footstool, Satan and death. All right, friends, when did Christ promise this? He would trample upon Satan's head. Does anyone know in the forum when? All right, friends, I'm waiting. When? It's Genesis chapter 3, verse 15. I'll put enmity between thee and the woman, between thy seed and her seed. It shall bruise thy head. That's it, my friends. Now, when did Jesus make Satan his footstool? When did Jesus crush Satan's head? All right, friends, it was at the crucifixion. Mark chapter 15, verse 22, the Bible tells us where Christ was crucified was on the hill called Golgotha. The place called Golgotha being interpreted the place of the skull whose skull was crushed, was smashed, was broken. Satan's head became Christ's footstool. What about death, the second enemy? Revelation chapter 1, verse 18. When Christ come on, friends, put it in the forum. Thank you so much. When Christ ascended, when Christ resurrected, he said, I have the key of hell and of death, my friends. So since Christ has already made his enemies his footstool, why has he not yet returned? Does anyone know in the forum what is he waiting on still? All right, my friends, he's waiting on us to get victory over sin, to make Satan our footstool. Go to Romans chapter 16. That's why we have midday power surge, my friends. So, Pastor, why do you share current events? It's the signs of the time, the clock on the wall, my friends. Does it make sense? How often do I check the timepiece throughout the day, especially when I'm busy? How often do you check your timepiece, the clock on your phone? How often? Minutes, frequently, friends. That's why we go through current events. But what is Christ waiting on? For us to make Satan our footstool. Romans chapter 16. So those who say, I don't want to hear about current events, they are hypocrites. Verse 20, Romans 16, the Bible says, and the God of peace shall bruise Satan under your feet shortly. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. All right, my friends. Do we all say amen? Amen to that, my friends. All right. Friends, does anyone know when Christ promised us power to make Satan our footstool? When, my friends? The same scripture. Anybody? Genesis chapter 3. Thank you for putting those amens in the chat room. Genesis chapter 3. Verse 15, I'll put enmity between thee and the woman, between thy seed and her seed. It shall bruise thy head. Amen. But of course, it will bruise Christ's heel. We'll also go through pain and suffering for Christ. Amen, my friends. What does enmity mean? Come on. Enmity in the forum, it means what? Come on, Save to Serve International Online. It means what? Hatred for sin, enmity, grace, God's grace, enmity, victory over sin. How can I receive that enmity? All right, friends, how can you receive enmity, hatred for sin to make Satan our footstool? Desire of Ages, page 300. It's by seeing what our sin does to Christ and surrendering. Real sorrow for sin is the result of the working of the Holy Spirit. Last two lines. By every sin, Jesus is wounded afresh. And as we look upon him whom we have pierced, we mourn for the sins that have brought anguish upon him. Such mourning will lead to what, my friends? The renunciation of sin. And write down Zechariah chapter 12 and verse 10. That's it. That's it, my friends. Now make this point clear. Put this point down. Christ is looking for footstool Christians to conquer Satan, conquer sin, footstool Christians, before I can become Christ's footstool Christians, before you can become a footstool Christian. We must spend much time at the footstool of mercy, the footstool of prayer. Look at this, my friends. The book Prayer, page 209, from top, it says, we are living in perilous times. Seventh-day Adventists are professedly the commandment-keeping people of God, but they are losing their devotional spirit. Man must come on bended knee as a subject of grace. We're, my friends, a suppliant at the footstool of mercy, footstool Christians. Next sentence, and as he receives daily mercies at the hand of God, we must thank God for victory over sin. Footstool Christians, would you say amen, my friends? Midday power surge, daily power surge. Coming to Christ, footstool of mercy. All right, friends, as I close, fathers, husbands, mothers, wives, children, we must all come to the footstool of prayer to receive power to become footstool Christians, crushing Satan's head. What do you say, my friends? Amen. Parents, teach your children to become footstool Christians, Bible workers, medical missionaries, pastors, evangelists, teach your Bible study contacts to become footstool Christians. Look at this statement, child guidance, page 488. Parents should seek to comprehend the fact that they are to train their children for the courts of God. When they are entrusted with children, it is the same as though Christ placed the children in their arms and said, train these children for me, that they may shine in the courts of God. One of the first sounds that should attract their attention is the name of Jesus. And in their earliest years, they should be led to where? To the footstool of prayer. What more can be said? Send in your prayer requests, my friends. Listen to this song.
Take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to thee. Take my hands and let them move at the impulse of thy love, at the impulse of thy love. Take my will and make it thine. It shall be no longer mine. Take my heart, it is thine own. It shall be thy royal throne. It shall be thy royal throne.